Happy New Year, 2021. Well, 2020 is over. What will 2021 bring? Brexit, pandemics, vaccines. Where will our soul find rest? Well, the psalmist tells us in Psalm 62 that God is the one in whom our souls will rest. Truly, my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I shall never be shaken. How long will you assault me? Would all of you throw me down, this leaning wall, this tottering fence? Surely they intend to topple me from the lofty place and take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Yes, my soul finds rest in God. My hope comes from him. Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I shall not be shaken. My salvation and my honour depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart to him, for God is our refuge. Surely the lowborn are but a breath, and the highborn are but a lie. If weighed in the balances, they are nothing. Together, they are only a breath. Do not trust in exhortation or put vain hope in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your hearts on them. One thing God has spoken, two things I have heard. Power belongs to your God, and with you, Lord, is unfailing love. And your reward, you reward everyone according to what they have done. Now, Martin Luther was somebody who understood and knew the problems of popes and plagues and persecution. And he wrote our next song. So let us stand and let us sing this song. A mighty fortress is our God.
Our God, a bulwark never failing, our helper, he amidst the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with on earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dusk ask who that may be, Christ Jesus, it is he, the Lord of hosts, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the
triumph through us, the Prince of Darkness.
encouraging words indeed. The right man by our side, the King forever, the King of glory. And more encouraging words. Luther understood he struggled with sin, but he knew that he was justified by faith alone, that Christ's righteousness was given not only to him, but to all of us. And so we can come before our God and we can confess our sins. And so we will do that. So with the words of the confession, say with me, Lord our God, we know that it was because of our sin that Jesus died upon the cross. Our ways too often resemble this corrupt generation, and we walk on the wrong path. We are cut to the heart by our willful rebellion and turn to you in repentance and faith. We call on the name of Jesus Christ and through his name receive forgiveness. Amen. Indeed, Lord, we thank you so much that we have forgiveness through your Son, that your Son stands on our side, that we stand with him, our rock and our salvation. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And now Jan will bring us our reading this morning.
So those of you who are able to stand, please stand while I read God's word to us from Ephesians chapter 4, the first 16 verses. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. That is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
So let's use our next song to not only declare our faith, but to encourage ourselves.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe in this broken generation. Dark, you help us.
There's only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more. Songs we sing, and in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit.
He has torn the veil, and we can come before our Lord in prayer. And so now, Viv Whitten will lead us in a time of intercession.
We start our prayers saying together the prayer the Lord Jesus Himself taught us. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are Yours, now and forever. Amen. We continue in prayer. Father, Your word clearly teaches that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Yet over the year just gone, there have been unprecedented trials on a global scale. Thousands have died, and yet that recognition of Your sovereignty has been conspicuous by its absence. Politicians still seek opportunity for short-term gains in both power and influence, trusting that medical science can provide all the answers. Yet history teaches us that this is simply not so. O Lord, when will we ever learn? Please have mercy on us. Please forgive our complacency and downright disobedience. Please strengthen the resolve of those with opportunity to make a difference. Please bring conviction of sin to the forefront in our society, and that we might then bow the knee, not to some liberal ideology, but to the one true God who identified so much with us that he came in person at that first Christmas. Father, at the beginning of a new year, we do pray for the faithful few who honour you in the lands where violent persecution of your people is endemic, lands where there is aggressive discrimination against your people. We think particularly about North Korea, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Syria, and Yemen, and pray that you would sustain your people, bring the wars and injustice to an end, so that the good news about Jesus might be freely proclaimed in each one. Here in the West, Lord, pressures are much more subtle, so we pray that we as a congregation of your people might build each other up and so avoid the snares of secularisation and complacency. Rather, may we serve you faithfully with evident zeal. Please help us to make a difference in our community. Please draw unbelievers to the Saviour and help us reach out with the love of Jesus to those around us, especially those from other cultures who have come to live in Hull. To that end, we particularly commit our leaders to you, for Scott, Pete and Rob, with their families, that they would preach the word faithfully, without fear or favour, and that they would lead with wisdom and grace, and that you would fill them with all your fullness. May 2021 be, we pray, a year of growth for the Christchurch network, and please preserve us from the wiles of the evil one. Many have been separated from loved ones this Christmas and have found it challenging. Nevertheless, in this new period of ongoing restriction, please help us the more to rely on you and reach out to those who we can. Particularly, we pray for our mission partners in far-off places, that you would help them cope with local restrictions and the particular demands of living in another culture. Please bless them and their families. For Charles, for the Pets, the Hunters, the Tinkers and the Frenchers, would you please keep them all safe, sustain them and prosper their gospel endeavours throughout 2021. These things we ask in the precious name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
So we shall use the next song to prepare our hearts and our minds to focus on Christ and his word before Liam comes to open God's word.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame.
Crown you now with every crown. Well, let me begin by saying Happy New Year to all of you watching at home. And before we turn to God's word and look more deeply at this passage, let's pray to God for his assistance. Lord Jesus, at one point during your ministry, a woman in the crowd cried out to you and said, "Blessed is the mother who gave you birth." And you replied, "Lord, blessed rather is he who listens to your word and obeys it." Lord, we pray that now we wouldn't simply be merely those who listen to your word, but who put it into practice. And Lord, we need your help to do that. Lord, by your spirit, transforming and changing us, help us to put your words into practice. And we ask this for your name's sake. Amen. Now, I wonder if this year you made any New Year's resolutions. They aren't something I really engage with properly, but I think it must be funny to think back on some of the ones that you might have had this last year with the hindsight that we have now. Some people might have made one to lose weight or to go to the gym more regularly. I think that one pretty soon went out the window. Some people decided to travel to places that they hadn't been before. Again, that one was probably scuppered. Some people might have resolved to learn a new skill. Now, during lockdowns, maybe that's one that you've ticked off your list. So maybe instead we should make resolutions for life and not just for New Year. The American preacher Jonathan Edwards laid out 70 resolutions to live by. They're a really interesting read, actually. Some of them make me laugh, such as number 15 on his list, which is resolved never to suffer the least motions of anger towards irrational beings. Now, that translated into modern English is simply, don't get angry at inanimate objects. Now, imagine how many times you might have had fits of rage at TV remotes, computer crashes, or objects you stub your toe on. That is a good resolution, really, isn't it? Well, today, you'll be relieved to hear that I'm only going to suggest one more resolution to add to your list, not 70. And even if you're not in the habit of making them, this one will serve us well whatever happens in this next year. And it's found in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Paul says, "I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received." This is a resolution that's worth having and will be something we should be aiming for whatever this next year brings. You see, we have a great calling that we've received as Christians. That's what Paul outlines in the first half of Ephesians. The great overarching plan that God has for all things, and we're made a part of it. Paul invites us to see that God is reconciling all things together under Christ. And that is and we're being reconciled together, all things under Christ, and that is part of this great grand plan that we're being brought into, both reconciled to God and to each other. Then, as the church, we form one new humanity and make known God's wisdom to all the powers that be, both on heaven and on earth. Now, it's a truly epic vision. And here Paul says that we are now to live lives worthy of that calling. That doesn't mean we should earn it, and it doesn't mean we should prove ourselves deserving of it. Ephesians chapter 1 spells that out in the clearest terms, that we are chosen by grace, not by merit. So what does Paul mean by living in a worthy manner? Well, it means that we are to live up to that reality. I think every business had a 2020 vision plan for this past year. So much expectation of what they were going to do and achieve. But no one saw this year coming. 2020 simply didn't live up to expectations. In the same way, Christians can live in a way that doesn't match the grand calling that we have in Christ. And instead, they can undermine it. So let's resolve together to not let that be us, and to heed the instruction of God's word here so that we can live in light of the great calling we've received. Now, there are three aspects of the worthy life which we're going to explore in this passage. The first is the character of the worthy life. The second, the unity of the worthy life. And then the responsibility of the worthy life. So let's first look at the character of the worthy life. If we are going to live up to this grand reality, what should our attitude be? Well, in verse 2, Paul says, be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. Now, these are characteristics that are worthy of God's ultimate redemptive plan. Now, do any of these surprise you? I mean, sure, they're fair qualities, but do they really strike you as being worthy of such a great grand calling? God's ultimate plan of reconciling all things under Christ is such a grand vision, and if our character is to represent that glorious reality, then don't you think these attributes come a bit as maybe just a bit soft, a bit uninspiring? Surely there's other attributes more worthy of our calling. Well, that's what the ancient world would have thought as well. At least in our day, we consider these characteristics to be somewhat positive, if a little underwhelming. But in Roman and Greek culture, the idea that these were honourable characteristics were laughable. No, the word used for humility was one that had broadly negative connotations in the Greek. It was one that was used for those who were subservient, who were slavish. It wasn't a compliment. Rather, those who displayed great strength, power, intellect, those were the worthy characteristics. And maybe you're thinking similarly. Maybe you're looking at these qualities and are failing to see the quality in them. Why would God want his people to be naive, weak pushovers? Well, he doesn't. You see, these virtues perfectly complement the calling we've received as Christians. We were chosen by God, according to his purposes and will. We didn't earn his favor. We didn't win a place in his grand plan. We were saved by grace. And therefore, our characters should be ones that affirm rather than undermine that reality. So instead of competing for God's favor at the expense of others, we can be assured of God's favor and selflessly look to the needs of others. Instead of making forceful demands of others, we can show the same gentleness and compassion that God has shown us. Instead of looking to cut off those who disappoint us, we forgive and forbear, conscious of how our faithful God has forgiven us. Now, does this make us weak? Does this belittle us? No, not at all. Simply, it shows what we understand of our calling. It shows we have a calling that doesn't revolve around us. Someone else is at the center of our universe, and that person is Jesus Christ. Now, one of the TV shows Jess and I are enjoying at the moment is watching through The Crown. Now, when you watch it, there is always a tension between the expectations placed on the royal family and the actions they take which undermine them. Now, unbecoming behavior of a royal does not disqualify them from being royal. But what it does do is undermine the crown. There is a way that royalty should behave, and that is worthy of their position. And similarly, a character worthy of our calling should not undermine Christ, but emulate him. In Christ, we are joined to the most royal family in God. And Jesus shows us what is becoming of someone part of his family. Now, in the year ahead, let's embrace the character of Christ rather than undermine it. Therefore, if you want to develop these Christ-like attitudes, these Christ-like attributes, let me encourage you in one way that we can do this. Continue to invest in members of the church family, whether they are agreeable or whether they are difficult to love, even at your own expense. The world says, no, help people, but right up until the point where it starts costing you. And at that point, you have to cut them loose. You need to say, no, they're toxic. But that is not how we are to behave. You do not belong to the world. You belong to Christ. And that attitude is just not becoming of someone who belongs to him. That attitude only serves to undermine Christ's crown. Christ showed us what complete humility looks like. He was the one who left the throne of heaven to descend to our lower earthly region. Yet he did so to die for those who were still rebelling against him. So then, if Christ was willing to humble himself before rebels like us, then we can persist in love to those who are hard work. We can show gentleness to those who make mistakes and disappoint us. And we can show forbearance to those who drain us, who drain our time, our resources, who tire us out. If you are resolved to live a life worthy of the calling you've received, then you need to continue to commit to people such as these, because that is what Christ did for you. Now, these characteristics will also help us to maintain the next aspect of the worthy life, and that's unity. If we are to live a life worthy of our calling, we must be united. Verse 3, Paul says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. Now, there's a reason why there's a lot of emphasis here. Unity is tricky. Don't expect that merely by gathering together again, we will be unified. You see, you can be gathered and yet not united. So we should be aware of this. Looking ahead to a year, which we hope, we will be able to gather again similarly to how we used to. To better understand this, let's look at how unity is presented in this passage. There are two types of unity here. One that is to be maintained, verse 3, and one that is to be attained, in verse 13. The one to be maintained is of the Spirit. The one to be attained is of the faith. Unity of the Spirit is what is the reality of all believers by virtue of them being a believer. All believers are united in that they have the same Holy Spirit at work in them. But then there's also the unity of faith. And that's something that is not yet fully reached and won't be perfectly until glory. This is the felt experience of unity between believers of faith, which varies depending on who the believer is. So the first is to be maintained because it already exists. The other is to be attained because it's something to strive towards. Now, yes, we are united by the Spirit regardless, but that felt experience of unity, that unity of faith, that needs to be worked at. Now, Paul is at pains to express the oneness that should be experienced between believers. If you look at verses 4 to 6, we see this expressed so richly. We are one body joined by the one Spirit. The same Holy Spirit that is in work in you is in work in all the believers around you, sanctifying and molding you by his power. How can sinners strive for holiness and remain united? Because the same Holy Spirit is powerfully transforming our lives. we are all called to one hope. We are all going the same place in Christ to be glorified and enjoy God's presence for eternity. So be at peace with those who are traveling in the same direction as you, even if they're traveling at a different pace. We have one Lord, the one who is sovereign over our lives and calls the shots, one place where we should receive instruction. We have one faith, one common hope in Christ that he is the one by whom we can come to know and be made right with God. We all have one baptism, one outward expression of that inner spiritual reality. We have one God and Father of all, over all, through all, and in all. And this shows us that no Christian is an exception. No believer falls into any other category. No one. It doesn't matter how difficult they are. It doesn't matter how much baggage they have. It doesn't matter what their stock is or their race. It doesn't matter what their age is or their temperament. All these things are superfluous compared to the oneness that we have together under Christ. Now, do we always feel like that? No. And that's the difference between the unity of the Spirit and the unity of faith. Reality and felt experience. To attain the unity of faith, we must focus on the oneness that we have, that we experience together in Christ, and let that drive our conversations and our dealings with one another. Overlook the surface differences in favor of the deeper connection between your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. You see, it's like we're in a band together. You may be a brilliantly talented guitarist, but if you're out of time with the drummer, you're going to make bad music. You may be a star singer, but if your sound doesn't harmonize with the other vocalists, you're going to make a terrible noise. Similarly, churches that are a gathering of individuals rather than a united people are not living lives worthy of their calling. They're making a bad noise. And the thing is, the world is not going to want to come and listen. As a result, we undermine our calling to display the manifold wisdom of God to everyone who looks at his church. And we see this in Ephesians 3:10. Therefore, resolve to make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit until we all reach the unity of faith. Now, this then leads us to the final aspect of the worthy life, which is responsibility. Now, you may have wondered what is going on in verses 7 and 8. Well, Paul here refers back to Psalm 68, in which God celebrates his triumph over Egypt and receives gifts from the people, or even he receives his people's gifts. Paul, however, shows that in Christ now, this speaks of a triumph over sin and death, and he gives gifts to the people. What are the gifts? Well, in verse 11 and 12, we see clearly the gifts to his people are his people. As he receives people in triumph, the captives he takes as we become followers of Jesus, he gives them back in service to further bless the church. So a life worthy of our calling has a responsibility. We are called not merely to be consumers, but to contribute. We are blessed by our calling, sure, yet we are also called to be a blessing according to the grace given to us as Christ apportions it. Now, how we contribute to the work of the church takes a variety of different forms, and that is not lost on Paul. You see, although we are called to unity, we're not called to uniformity. Paul recognizes the diversity in the church family. And this is expressed in verses 12 and 16, where Paul shows that the church is a body, with each part doing their bit to support and build up the body as a whole. Now, if you think of a band again, you've got different musicians, haven't you? With different contributions they make, which all adds to the music. Now, one of the ways churches undermine this is by assuming that the front man, the lead man, is all that matters, and you can do away with the rest of the band. Well, the pastor has all the responsibility, and everyone else, well, they're expendable. But to think this way undermines the calling that we've received. Just look at verse 11. We see that Christ gives his people to his people as his blessing. Who are these people specifically? Well, the apostles, the prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. They are a series of roles which are focused on the word of God. Now, these are important roles, but the temptation is to stop there and read no further. But what are these people given for? Verse 12, to equip the people for works of service. All believers have a responsibility to play their part. Now, instead of a band this time, imagine an orchestra. God's word is like the music on the page. It's what everyone should be following. God sets the tempo, writes the music, and we are all contributing our bit as long as it conforms to what's on the page. These word-based ministries are like the conductors directing the musicians. All the different varieties of musicians, you have the brass, you have the woodwind, you have the percussion, they all work together as the great composer designed them to. And the conductor make sure that they are keeping to the music. Now, that's an important role. But you wouldn't want to go and watch a conductor with no orchestra, would you? No onlookers are going to be impressed by seeing some guy waving his hands at the front to some just notes on a page. And in the same way, God hasn't called believers to simply sit under faithful teaching, but to bring it to life as they apply it and are equipped for works of service. And this is what is truly beautiful and glorifies God. Unfortunately, churches can sometimes be described more like a football match than an orchestra. Hundreds of spectators desperately needed of some exercise and 22 players desperately in need of a rest. But that's not how the church is meant to be. The reality is that we are all called to works of service. And the spectators are really the unbelievers around us. I truly believe there is great cause for encouragement in this area here, especially considering how you have poured yourselves out in service over this past year with all the changes, with all the difficulties that we've had to go through together. You look at the ministries and you see how so many different people are involved. You've given your creativity, your time, you've given your energy, and you've poured them into the things that we've done in this past year. Look at how you've used things like the crib videos and the mountain series to take God's word to the people around you, to strike up gospel conversations, to offer real hope in Christ when the world realized it didn't have anything to offer. Look how you've sought to care for one another over this past year and provide for those in need. How you've done that through the food drop-offs and the giving. Let me encourage you to continue on and grow in this regard. After all, as Paul shows, this is a matter of maturity. This is something that we can continue to grow in until we reach the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. The challenge for us is to continue to use our gifts as Christ has apportioned them. Let's not fall back into spectating, but encourage one another to get on the pitch as we apply God's word to our lives. Now, in this way, let's resolve to live lives that are worthy of our calling. And with the help and power of the Holy Spirit at work in us, we will. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for the grand calling that we have in Christ. Help us, we pray, to live up to your calling with all diligence and enthusiasm as you work your eternal purposes out in our lives. We ask this all for your name's sake. Amen.
I believe we've heard the Spirit speaking this morning, urging us to walk and live a life worthy of the Lord. And so, Christchurch Newland, we need to resolve to do that. Maybe we could print off the text that we've seen, stick it beside your bed, stick it on the inside of your front door, so that every time you see it, you will be reminded of these words that we resolved at the beginning of 2021, of what we will do. And we will keep reviewing it every time we see these words and won't just have to think about it again in 2022. So let us pray and let us move forward as a church. Maybe listen to this sermon again to reflect on the words that we have heard. And so as we leave, let us sing our final song, Come Praise and Glorify Our God. And let's use this as an anthem for 2021, that this is how our lives will be, praising and glorifying the Lord our God. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, you are the God who we praise, that you are the God who saves. And we pray that as we begin 2021, that we would go out and we would bring glory and praise to your name, that you would give us boldness and courage to speak the gospel wherever we might find ourselves. That, Lord, that you would encourage us along, that you'd open those doors, that we might go in and bring the light of the gospel to men and women. Amen. Amen. Amen.